discovery and distance. But in recent years, many other endocrine organs play an important role in endocrinology, like the gut, liver, kidney, pancreas, and many other organs. So the endocrine organs represent all these glands beside other organs like GLT, liver, pancreas, and kidney. But what about the endocrine function of the kidney? Kidney secretes many important hormones like erythrobutyrene, renin, 1,25-dihydrocholecalciferol or vitamin D, the active form of vitamin D. But the kidney plays another important role in endocrine homeostasis. During fasting, the liver produces about 95% of the glucose needed by all organs of the body. The kidney secretes 5 to 10% of the glucose. The liver secretes glucose by two mechanisms, glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. But the kidney secretes glucose by gluconeogenesis. In patients with diabetes, the renal threshold nearly in almost of diabetic patient is elevated. So we can see blood sugar exceeding 200 and no sugar in urine. So the kidney play an important role in endocrine homeostasis. The disturbance in hormonal level is very important in patients with chronic kidney disease. Either there is an increased circulatory hormone level or decreased circulatory hormone levels by toxic materials, or there is resistance to the action of many hormones at the level of receptors. So we can see in patients with chronic kidney disease, increased circulatory hormone level when there is decreased glomerular filtration rate in patients with
clearance.
The hormones that increased in patients with chronic kidney disease are insulin.
The second is increased secretion. محصور الناس بتوعنا هم بره بس
تمام ماشي. طب حضرتك هو النهارده مش تصوير ده بالليل صح؟
ليه؟ ده بالعكس ده الصور هنا اوجب.
هو ما يجي الساعه كام؟
طب انا
ده بالعكس التصوير النهارده هو النهارده عاوز
which is secreted from the testes, estrogen, which is secreted from mainly from the ovary and the progesterone. These hormones are decreased in patients with chronic kidney disease. I will summarize this altered data in the end of my lecture. What about erythrobutyl? I take it in short. The source of erythrobutyl is mainly from the kidney. Retubular cells of renal cortex, about 90%, and about 10% from the liver. Erythrobutyl is stimulated by hypoxia and angiotensin B. What about the abnormalities in secretion of erythrobutyl in chronic kidney disease? In patients with chronic kidney disease, there is decreased secretion of erythrobutyl from the kidney, which represents the main source for erythrobutyl. So there is erythrobutyl deficiency. But there is other factors contributing for anemia rather than erythrobutyl, like toxic effect of uremic materials, reduced red cell survival, and increased blood cell turnover or destruction, with reduced uptake, absorption, and utilization of dietary iron. This is the second hormone secreted by the kidney, the active form of vitamin D. So in patients with chronic kidney disease, we face many patients with marked vitamin D deficiency, especially when 25-dihydroxy or calciferol, the active form of vitamin D. What about the abnormalities in vitamin D metabolism in patients with chronic kidney disease? In chronic kidney disease, there is one alpha hydroxylation, the 1-alpha hydroxylation of 25-hydroxy vitamin D to 1,25-dihydroxy vitamin D is impaired due to the lack of 1-alpha hydroxylation or 1-alpha hydroxylase enzyme. The prevalence of vitamin D deficiency may reach up to 80% in patients with chronic kidney disease, especially in stage 5. There is additional increased plasma concentration of fibroblast growth factor 23. There is now trials about fibroblast growth factor 1 in remission of type 2 diabetes. In animal studies and in phase 3 clinical study, there is remission of diabetes by fibroblast growth factor 1 injection intracranially in animals and by nasal route in human, and also by the peripheral route, fibroblast growth factor 1 may play an important role in the next decade in treating or curing type 2 diabetes. This is abnormalities of vitamin D in patients with chronic kidney disease. There is lack of 1,25-dihydroxycholine calciferol with marked reduction in vitamin D activity. The third endocrine disorders seen in patients with chronic kidney disease is secondary hyperparathyroidism. Secondary hyperparathyroidism is common in patients with chronic kidney disease, patients under hemodialysis, or even tertiary hyperparathyroidism. This figure showed the contributing factors for the occurrence of secondary hyperparathyroidism. There is decreased 125 level of vitamin D, increased serum phosphate, which lead to activation of parathyroid gland, which lead to secondary hyperparathyroidism. Professor Hussein told me that I will talk about endocrine disorders rather than glucose disturbance or diabetes. But in short, there is disturbance in carbohydrate metabolism in chronic kidney disease, and also there is disturbance in insulin metabolism. There is impaired insulin clearance. There is decreased uptake of glucose by the muscle and adipose tissue in patients with chronic kidney disease. There is decreased in secretion of endogenous glucose by the kidney, and decreased beta cell function in patients with chronic kidney disease. What about insulin metabolism? There is marked insulin resistance in patients with CKD. There is decreased degradation of insulin. There is decreased degradation of insulin. So when we inject insulin from outside, exogenous insulin for treating type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes who failed on oral hypoglycemic agent, we noticed that small dose of insulin can cause hypoglycemia due to decreased clearance of insulin. But in patients with chronic kidney disease, there is significant insulin resistance. There is significant insulin resistance. But what about muscarinic? This is very important point in my lecture. What about growth hormone, especially in children? There is increased in the level of growth hormone, as I explained in the first slide. There is increased the level of growth hormone, but there is growth retardation in patients with chronic kidney disease, in spite of elevated growth hormone. Why? There is growth hormone resistance. There is growth hormone resistance. So we face in patients with growth retardation, when we measure the basal or even the stimulated growth hormone, we can say elevated level of growth hormone. But there is a stunted growth or retarded growth. What about the growth hormone deficiency in adults? Growth hormone deficiency in adults is very important. It leads to muscle weakness, leads to muscle weakness, decreased a marked asthenia, A very important question. How can we correct the stunted growth in children with chronic kidney disease? Can patients benefit from growth hormone injection in spite of the presence of growth hormone deficiency? Many papers indicated that growth hormone injection may be beneficial in children and even in adults with disturbed growth hormone metabolism. When we give recombinant growth hormone injection, in a child with chronic kidney disease, we see improvement in all parameters. So it is advised to give children growth hormone, the recombinant form of growth hormone, to manage the stunted growth. But what about the adult? Can we give growth hormone for adults who showed marked asthenia and muscle weakness?
This is a question.
Yes, this is a question, and I need an answer or interaction.
There are two points from my aspects or perspectives. If I recommend deficiency that's associated with problems like muscle asthenia, fatigability, so it's very rational to leave growth hormone for others. However, I am totally aware by opportunity trial, which was randomized control trial, done in Dallas patients, and it was prematurely terminated because of no difference. But again, my opinion, and Professor Mujahid will teach us today, my opinion, if I document a deficiency, I suggest to give growth hormone to others.
Any other opinion?
please. Yes, please. Mike, please.
Thank you, Prof. If I understood you very well, you said that the growth hormone, the problem is not with the level of growth hormone, but at the tissue level. So if you give exogenous growth hormone, where would the effects be? At the tissue level, or that's what I need to understand before we
yes. There is a resistance for growth hormone at the endocrine.
Yes.
So we give higher doses of growth hormone to overcome the resistance at the level of endocrine growth receptors.
Even after transplantation of pancreas, there is some concern about inducing sclerosis, venous sclerosis. However, in the Western community, they consider the height is very crucial. To be tall, this is advantage, and this is so they can pay the price even if there is a risk of venous sclerosis and this is particular in children. So growth hormone for stunted growth children, I think no doubt to be given, and for adults there is big debate. But if we have a patient, adult patient, who is athletic, fatigued, and I have nothing to do, and growth hormone deficiency is suspected or confirmed, I suggest giving growth hormone.
There is controversy in all literature about growth hormone in adults. But there is all guidelines agree that we must give growth hormone for children. But about adults, there is many controversy about giving growth hormone to adults.
Do you prefer growth
hormone? Yes, I prefer to give growth hormone in patients with marked asthenia, muscle weakness, even the growth hormone deficiency in adults may give cognitive dysfunction. So I prefer to give growth hormone for others who are not seeing muscle weakness and cognitive function.
If you allow me, Professor Magath, to have a moment here, we shouldn't wait until the patient recovers. Wasting the low doses, even that we are preparing for death. So this is our job. It is to avoid muscle wasting.
There is no thyroid hormone disturbance in CKD. A number of abnormalities has been described in chronic kidney disease. The total and the free T4 tetrahydrocyanine are either decreased or normal. But the active form of thyroid hormone is T3. T4 is converted peripherally to 2-3. And 2-3 is the active form of thyroid hormone. T4 is called pro-hormone. It's called pro-hormone. T3, either free or total, are decreased. Are commonly decreased in patients with chronic kidney disease. T4 may be normal. But what about, it's very important, what about the hypothalamic, hypophysarial axis?
hypoceramic hypophysial axis that controls the cellular level. What about the TSH? TSH is secreted from the pituitary, the anterior pituitary gland, from the thyroid lobes, which elicit its action on the thyroid gland that increase synthesis and secretion of T4 and TSH. What about TSH in patients with chronic kidney disease? Normal TSH, but the very important point is there is delay in the action of TSH, or there is a retarded feedback mechanism. If T3 and T4 decrease, TSH will increase by the feedback mechanism. This interaction between the thyroid gland and the pituitary, and even the hypothalamus TRH, is disturbing in patients with chronic kidney disease. So, there is normal TSH level despite no thyroid hormone. This is very important. There is alteration in the diurnal and nocturnal TSH surge. There is disturbance in the circadian rhythm of TSH. There is poor response to decrease the or increase the level of T3 and T4. There is blunted response to TSH to thyroglobulin releasing hormone. The TRH is secreted from the hypothalamus, or even if we administer TRH referrally, we find blunted response of TSH. If we give TSH or administer TSH, this result in an increase in T3, but a blunted response in T4. Can I ask a small question? What is the main hormone secreted by the thyroid gland? T4 or T3? T4. T3? T3. T4?
T3 at the house.
T4 is the main hormone secreted from the thyroid follicle. But the active form is T3. T4 is converted peripherally to T3. So the active form is T3. But the main hormone secreted by the thyroid gland is T4. So if we administer TSH, this result in increase in T3, but in a blunt response in T4. A blunt response in T4. How can I manage a patient with thyroid disorder in chronic kidney disease, with chronic kidney disease? Despite biochemical abnormalities of serum TSH level, still, this is very important, still remains a good indicator of hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism in chronic kidney disease. So we depend mainly in diagnosing patients with hyperthyroidism in chronic kidney disease, we depend mainly on TSH. and not only T3 and T4.